and thank you for spending some time with me today. My name is Monica. I am a developer advocate at Starburst. I have one request. If the US scores, someone please tell me, because I am not able to watch the end of the game. But let's get started. Let's jump into working with how to get the most out of your data lake architecture with Starburst Galaxy. First, let's talk about data lakes. They're awesome. They're a place to store all of your centralized data at scale. However, if you're like me, you have spent a little bit too much time trying to navigate through that data lake to find the information that you want. Frankly, it's very hard to get the information that you desire out of your data lake if you don't have the proper configurations and organization in place. Don't just take my word for it alone. This is straight from the horse's mouth from AWS. The main challenge with the data lake architecture is that raw data is stored with no oversight of the contents. So never fear, I'm not going to give you a problem without a solution. By applying the proper governance, security, and controls, you can actually level up your data lake to a data lakehouse. A data lakehouse converges the principles of a data lake and a data lakehouse by adding together to create the best of both worlds and leverage those data warehouse-like capabilities on the data lake. So assuming everyone here has capitalized on S3 object storage, you then need to select your scalable query engine together to implement those controls to build out your data lakehouse. So we want to say, why do you want to use Starburst as data lakehouse? There are just a couple of reasons, and then we can go on from there. But some of the reasons why you should use Starburst is because of the flexibility to run both interactive and long-running queries. We also have the ability to connect with file formats such as Apache Iceberg, Delta Lake, and Hootie, and integrate seamlessly with AWS products and services, which we will see during the demo. So I know this says a Starburst data lakehouse, but really this talks about how to choose, like, integrate any sort of data lakehouse using your scalable query engine and your object storage of choice. The three things you need to consider are utilizing those OpenTable formats for that data warehouse-like functionality. You also need to implement native security to add that data governance, and then build out your reporting structure to provide organization. So the first thing we want to discuss is talking about those OpenTable formats. Basically, the OpenTable formats like Iceberg, Delta Lake, and Hootie allow you to deliver that data warehouse-like functionality through the merge, delete, ACID transactions, all of the above. They also let you store your object catalogs and manage the rest behind the scenes. Starburst Galaxy will actually do all of the work for you when you're managing these OpenTable formats and lets you integrate multiple OpenTable formats together at once. Next, we're going to talk about the incorporating native security to ensure your data governance and compliance. Essentially, what you want to do is give all of your users the correct information to do their jobs, but not one access more. Starburst Galaxy lets you assign privileges down to the table level or even the location level in object storage so that you can configure the proper access to the proper users. As an administrator, you can also customize specific roles for multiple different roles as well. So we'll see later in the demo where we have an account admin role as well as a consume layer role so that the two have very distinct privileges. You can also configure your SSO identity provider to include Starburst Galaxy as a supported application, which is currently supported by Okta, Azure AD, and Google Workspace. So to get the most out of your data lake, you also need to implement organization. One way to do this is to build out a reporting structure which has defined data layers for certain criteria. So the first layer is the land layer. That's just your raw data that's landed into S3. The second layer is your structure layer, which is cleaned and optimized. And your third layer is your consume layer, which is actually ready to be queried by the end users. So basically, what we're going to do is talk about our demo structure now. So we're going to do the premise of this example is we have Pokemon Go data being ingested into our LAN layer in S3. And this is going to have geolocation data information. It's going to have latitude, longitude, all of the different types of small spawn information of where those Pokemon are landing. Then what we're going to do is clean and optimize that data with the Pokemon Go MongoDB data stored in the Pokédex in MongoDB. That has all of the ability information that we do not have because it's a the geolocation data we want to keep simple. So what we're going to do is we're going to basically make some meaningful information out of those two data choices by combining the two together and building out our structure layer. So what we're going to do is use Starburst Galaxy to read the data from the LAN layer, then clean and optimize that data into more performant org files in the structure layer. And then the last step is going to be joining the spawn data with the Pokédex data together to create some clean and ready to be used data consumer tables. We're also going to do some visualizations to analyze which Pokemon are most common to spawn within the San Francisco Bay Area. We're going to be using ThoughtSpot for that. OK, so now I'm going to switch over so we can get started on that demo. And I'm going to press a button. Perfect, we got going. OK, so here on the screen, you can see the Pokemon Go Pokédex data, which has all of the ability information stored for multiple different Pokemon together. Here is the CSV geolocation data. It's very bare bones. It just has the identification information, latitude, longitude, as well as the spawn information, so encounter information. Basically, what I want to show you here is the ThoughtSpot live board, which we will then be populating after we create our consume table. Right now, it's empty because we have not built that yet. So we're then going to pop into Starburst Galaxy. And what we're going to do is create two different catalogs, both to AWS and to MongoDB. The first catalog we're going to do is connecting our catalog to AWS so that we can get that access. I'm going to name it AWS Ketchum along with the Pokemon theme. And what I'm going to do is use AWS access key to connect to that catalog. Here's the information going in there. And then the next thing we want to do is connect to our metastore, which we're going to be using Glue. And we are going to allow external reading and writing to external tables. And then the final thing here that we're going to be doing after we type this in is selecting our default table format. That's what I talked about earlier. We've selected Iceberg for this example. We'll also be using Hive. So next thing we're going to do is create our second catalog, which connects to MongoDB. And so we're just going to put the connection URL in there as well as the name. And I'm going to name this PokemonGoDB, a little pun on words. And then we're going to have all of the information we need to get started with our catalogs. And then once that connection is tested, the next thing we need to do is create our cluster so that we can connect to both of those data sources at once. So I'm going to create that cluster. I'm going to name it my favorite Pokemon as a child. And then we're going to add those two clusters or two catalogs that we just previously created. And we're going to leave the cluster with execution mode off. We're not doing anything super crazy intensive-wise. So the cluster is getting running. And what I'm going to do behind the scenes is add all of the necessary permissions that we need so that we can get started in the query editor. So that goes back to the native security we discussed earlier. So once that cluster is up and running, we're going to navigate to the query editor and get started. We have selected our cluster. We've selected our AWS catalog. And the next thing we need to do is select our schema. The first schema we're going to create is the Hive schema for the LAN layer. I wanted to separate the LAN and the structure and consume tables just to show that you can interoperate with different table formats. So we're creating Hive to start. Then we're going to build our Pokemon Spawns landing table, which has all that information coming in from that CSV. We're going to pull it from the external location and create that CSV format table. Once that runs, we're just going to validate that the data comes in looking as it should. There we have it. And then the next thing we're going to do is build out our structure layer. So we're going to actually create a new schema specifically for our iceberg tables. And that's going to contain our two structure tables and our consume table. The first structure table we're going to build is the Pokédex table, which is going to be pulling the data from Pokemon Go DB and doing data transformations to get the data types into the correct format. We're also going to be creating the ORC file, and again, using the iceberg default table format. So once that runs, you can see that we will have that table being recreated in the structure layer. We've done a little bit of manipulation to it, which is why it lands in the structure layer. Everything looks as expected. And so the next thing to do, you can see all of the information there in that big table. The next thing to do is create our structure for our geolocation data, our spawn data. We're removing two different columns. We're not going to use the S2 ID identification information. We are going to be doing data manipulation again to create our data formats in the right type. And we are using ORC file format as well. And this one will be an iceberg table as opposed to the Hive table previously. So once that's run, we're just going to double check that it looks as it expects. Same thing with the two columns removed, and it's been built up. Now we're going to build our consume table, which takes our two structure tables and combines them together, while also only selecting the latitude and longitude in the Bay Area. So we'll have the type 1, type 2, and legendary status along with all of that geolocation information. So we have that done. And the next thing we're going to do is select from that table, show the values. Looks as expected as the two tables join together with the information from the geolocation and the type information. So I want to show you some of the native security aspects within Starburst Galaxy. We have created two different roles here. So I'm in the account admin role right now. And we're going to show that we can update this table, expect it to be null, but the update permissions do indeed work. Now we're going to just select from the table again to show that we have that permission and just validate as we've seen before. Now we're going to switch over to the consume layer access, which has specifically been built for our end users who we don't want touching our table. So they have select access, but they do not have the access to update the table as seen. You get the access denied error. That's just in the hands of the account admins or whoever else we want to assign it to. Now we're going to pop over to ThoughtSpot and refresh so that we can see the different information coming up on the screen. The live board has been refreshed from that consume table. Here we have the Pokemon prevalence by name, as well as the different types. And then you can see the geolocation information. This usually is a country data set, but it's just been optimized to the San Francisco area. So you can see the number of spawns and where you should go if you're looking to hunt Pokemon. Alcatraz looks like a good place, somewhere if you're interested. And then we can also see the type of Pokemon, which makes sense because we included a lot of water in our data. So valid that in our geolocation, there's a lot of water Pokemon. And you can also see that flying is pretty prevalent as a type 2 Pokemon. Again, makes sense because of that water geolocation information. One more cool thing that we're going to show is popping back over to Starburst Galaxy. We can look at the query history and see all of the data or all of the different query text for executing through ThoughtSpot. So it's just showing a little bit of the interconnectivity between the two and how you can actually then go recreate these queries if you want. So thank you guys so much for joining me. If you have any questions, please come stop by our booth. We'd be really happy to chat with you. So you guys have a great rest of your days.